Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord. We appreciate you joining in with us today. This is Pastor Randy Richardson for the Bible Heritage Pentecostal Holiness Church in Waycross, Georgia. We're going to start off the service today with I Saw the Light. Praise God. Hallelujah. Wonder so aimless, life filled with sin, I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm happy, so sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man wandered along, worries and fears I claimed for my own. Then Jesus, like a blind man, gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Of the Lord, and God can give that to you if you'll just ask Him for it. I regularly pray, Lord, cover this sanctuary, this church property, the parsonage, our children and their homes. Cover that with the blood of Jesus. Set the angels around the perimeters of our property and protect us in Jesus' name. And I know He does it. He's a fence all around me every day. Jesus, be a fence all around me every day. Jesus, I want you to protect me as I travel along life's way. I know you can, I know you will. Fight my battles while I just keep still, Lord. Be a fence all around me every day. Jesus, be a fence.
Soldier, he can't trust. Keep on the firing line.
like that song keeps coming back to me. And it's a song that says, there will be peace in the valley for me. Hallelujah. I don't know what valley you might be in today, what you're struggling with, but God can send the peace that passes all understanding to fill your heart and mind. Hallelujah. Well, I'm tired and so weary, but I know. Camera over just a little bit. Today I want to start a new series that kind of tail ends on the last series that we did on divine healing. Help if I grab the microphone, wouldn't it? I said we want to start a new series today on demons. And you say, well, I don't really want to know much about demons. Well, you need to know about demons. If you're going to help people in this world today, they are bound by the devil. They are bound by his demonic spirits. And Jesus has given us the commission to cast out devils. And I want to say that this series is going to be more teaching, a little preaching, but mostly teaching and illustrations to help you understand about this subject. It's going to take several weeks to get through it, and I hope that at the end you'll be praying for God's anointing and the Holy Ghost to fall upon you so that you'll be able to help your children, your grandchildren, your neighbors, the people down the street, the people you happen to run into at the supermarket. Alicia was at the Walmart or Ollie's or somewhere here just a few weeks back. And right as she was walking by this person, the Holy Ghost gave her discernment about what was going on in this person's life. And she reached out to the person and began to reveal the things that God had shared with them. And then she prayed over the spirits that were binding them. So this is something that you need to know. You need to be able to help people. I've seen firsthand with my own children. My oldest daughter, there was a short period of time that she allowed herself to get some help. And she went to this program, and my son and my daughter-in-law, my wife and I, we went into a room and we said, "Are you willing to get deliverance? Are you willing to be set free by the power of the Holy Ghost?" And she at first said yes, and my son took charge because I'm too much daddy, and daddy was getting in the way. And but nonetheless, I witnessed coming out of the mouth of my own daughter strange voices and demonic spirits talking to us. And so, folks, I'm telling you, there is a reality. There is a reality of the supernatural. And so I've entitled this message, "Are Demons Real? Are Demons Real?" I can unequivocally answer that and say, yes, they are. Most churches don't deal with this subject, and they allow people to sit in the pew full of the devil, and it's a shame, and it doesn't need to happen that way. I believe that God is calling people from the north, the south, the east, and the west, and that they are going to come into this house of worship, and I believe they're even going to come into Waycross, and that many churches are going to experience an overwhelming revival of God's Holy Spirit. And Jesus is going to be in the middle of it all, and if you study the Gospels, you'll see that Jesus spent one-third of his ministry healing the sick. He spent one-third of his ministry casting out devils, and the last one-third just reaching the lost. And I believe that's the formula for church growth. I don't believe we ever need to advertise and publicize and emphasize church growth as our main reason. People is our main reason. We want to see people set free by the power of the Holy Ghost. In my 40 years of ministry, I've encountered all types of demonic spirits and people that were oppressed of the devil and people that were possessed of the devil. And some people started having problems because they were molested as a child, or they were abused or raped or hurt. And some people just get sick because of genetics, because the virus is floating in the air and they catch it that way. But there is a suffering that some people go through, whether it's mental, physical, emotional, spiritual, whatever it is, because of demonic influence. And as God's people, remember I did a series on the gifts of the Holy Spirit. One of the gifts is discerning of spirits. And you need to be spirit-filled. You need to have the baptism in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. You need that glorious experience. It opens the door for you to have the discerning of spirits and the other gifts of the Spirit. We have got to discern whether a person is suffering because of a physical problem, a mental problem, an emotional problem, or spiritual demons. We have to be led of the Holy Ghost. We have to be sensitive to the Spirit of God. We have to operate in wisdom and understanding. We have to know the Word of God. We've got to be able to find a scripture to hold on to with different people's situations. And so we've got to be stable, sincere Christians with the heart of God, able to resist the devil and see him flee. Hallelujah. Our motives must not be popularity, position, fame, money, or any other reason. It should only be to help the hurting people that are here in our area and those that are watching by way of the internet. So let's dive into this subject, and I may have to cut it short due to time, but we'll see and see where we're at. We ask the question, are demons real? I just come home from church, and a family that I was ministering to had a wife who was a paranoid schizophrenic. Several in the family had dabbled with witchcraft. This lady's sister was a high priestess in the Church of Satan. And this lady, the sister, had walked around the home of this dear lady many times, putting curses and spells on her sister and on her children. And so I learned about the situation and was asked by the family to come and minister. And so I grabbed one of my deacons and we went over to the house. We anointed every doorpost. We anointed every window. We anointed every person. We prayed over the house and commanded the spirits to leave in the name of Jesus. Well, the man of the house had a daughter who had been choked every night. The demons would jump on top of her and they would press her down into the bed and choke her, and she felt like she was going crazy. And so this deacon and I, we went into this house and we did spiritual warfare and we commanded the spirits to leave that house in the name of Jesus. We believed God for the family members with mental illness and broke curses that were over the family. So a few months went by and the family had started going to church and reading God's word, and they were coming out of mental illness. They were coming out of every situation that they were facing. So the man of the house one day, he didn't come to church. He stayed home. He thought to himself, well, now my family's better and I don't have to work so hard now. And well, I deserve a Sunday off. I can go fishing and just rest a little bit, you know, how people do. And so he goes into the bathroom to shave, and while he's shaving, he hears a voice that says, I'm back, I'm back, I'm back, I'm back, I'm back, I'm back, I'm back. And he turned around and said, I didn't know you were here, because he didn't believe any of this stuff. He just thought that it was a bunch of hooey. So he calls me up and he says, I heard something in my house. I said, well, the Bible says that when the house is swept clean, that the demons will come back to the house and they'll bring seven times worse with them. And so he said, well, come back and bring your deacon and you pray over my house again, because I don't want them back in my house. So we did. I want to prepare you how to do spiritual warfare in a house. I had a young man one time. I was working for the Department of Juvenile Justice. And this young boy went on he was a good boy, just a good boy. He was raised in the church. His parents had backslid, though, and they quit going to church. And he quit going to church because mom and daddy quit going to church. And so here's this teenager. He's just doing what teenagers do, and he got with the wrong crowd. Next thing you know, he stole about six or seven cars in his community. So I get the call to go to his house because he's under 18 years of age. He fell under the Department of Juvenile Justice. I was a counselor with them at the time. And so I go to the house,
And when I get there, I'm doing the paperwork for the intake and letting him know what the courts are willing to do for his situation and what he can do to straighten his situation out and how he can do better. And all of a sudden, the Spirit of the Lord moved on me. I had no knowledge about these people whatsoever. Never met them, never saw them in the store. Just the Spirit of God gave me a great revelation. And I looked at the family and I said, look, I wear two hats. I'm a pastor and I also am a counselor with the Department of Juvenile Justice. So I said, I don't want to offend you. I don't want to get fired from my job. But I keep feeling a pull from the Holy Spirit to minister to your son that's on him as a demon. And would you mind if I prayed over him? And they looked at me and they both said, no, we don't mind at all. We're believers and we would like for you to do that. So I looked at the boy and I just fell under the Holy Ghost influence. And I pointed my finger at him and I said, that which is on you, you allow demons to come and oppress you. And they need to come off of you and you need to go back to God. You need to return to the Lord. I said, are you willing to come back to God? He said, yes, I am. And I said, in the name of Jesus. And I put my hand, I just barely touched the top of his head. And that boy fell out in the Holy Ghost. And that demon left him. He got up from there. And he began to rejoice in the Lord. The mother weeping her eyes out. And she says, we have been backslidden. We need to come back to God. The daddy said, I need to get right with God. So I led that family back to God. We prayed them back through into a relationship with Jesus Christ. About 3 months later, their pastor saw me at the store. And he walked over to me and says, Pastor, you don't know me. He said, but I pastor such a church. And he said, such family, do you remember them? And I said, oh, yeah, I did the intake for them. He said, you did a little more than the intake. He said, you took authority over the devil. And that family has turned around 180 degrees and they're serving the Lord. And the young man's back in the youth group and he's serving God and doing everything he's supposed to do. You see, there was a spirit behind that situation. So I want to prepare you how to do that kind of thing and to be led of the Spirit of God. Well, Mark 3, verse 14 through 15. Mark 3, verse 14 through 15 says, then Jesus appointed 12 that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach and to have power to heal sicknesses and to cast out demons. Jesus appointed the 12 apostles and gave them power to change people's lives through healing of sicknesses and disease and casting out devils. I hope today to accomplish answering four questions. What are demons? Where do they come from? What is their function? And how do they enter? We may not get through them all, but I'm hoping that we will. First, what are demons? Demons are Satan's soldiers. I think it's the best way to describe it. You see, the demonic force fell from heaven. A third of the angels left with Lucifer, and they decided they were going to overrule God, and God kicked them out of heaven. They're a highly organized army under Satan as commander-in-chief. Kenneth Hagin Sr. wrote in his little book about demons and devils, he said, evil spirits are fallen beings who seek embodiment, and when a demon embodies a man, it makes that man what it is. So in other words, let's just say you got a spirit of lust. Well, then you're going to be consumed by the lust. The lust is just going to take over your mind. It's going to influence every thought of your day. And so Satan's spirit of lust can attach itself to you and oppress you. And if you're not careful and you're not right with God, it can possess you. Well, the first choice of demons is to operate inside of people, okay, or attached to people, oppressed. The second choice, as we saw in the scriptures where they begged the Lord to cast them into the pigs, they will inhabit animals. You will see some rabid acting animals that are full of the devil, and you have to take authority over them. When I was working the census, I saw so many devil dogs, and I love dogs, and most dogs come right up to me, and I love them. You know, I'm not afraid of animals, not afraid of dogs. But there was a few of them I had to say, in the name of Jesus, you know your place, and stay away from me right now in Jesus' name. And they stayed right where they were. So they like to inhabit humans, mainly, and they operate in the atmosphere. They like to go over regions and possess regions. And that's why you'll find in different areas of the country, different areas of the world, that there are certain evil presences that are more prominent in certain areas. The Bible says in 1 Peter 5:8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. See, the devil wants to devour people. He wants to possess them. My oldest daughter, I can't carry on a conversation because she is possessed with the devil of drugs. She's so possessed with it that she doesn't, the things that she wants to do, she doesn't do because she's so possessed by the devil. The devil wants to devour our young people. And he's doing it right and left. And they're dying right and left, overdosing right and left, because the spirit of suicide. Spirits are influencing young people to kill themselves because they're seeking whom they may devour. Okay, remember that word, devour. Ephesians 2:2 says, in which you once walked according to the course of the world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. Oh, Satan wants to be rampantly involved in our lives. But I'm commanded by the Bible to resist the devil and see him flee. Well, I believe there are different demons that do different tasks, just like there's different angels that do different tasks. Ephesians 6:11 through 12 says, put on the whole armor of God that you might be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual wickedness, the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. So in the atmosphere over Waycross, Georgia, we have demonic spirits just like every other city in the United States. We have principalities. That's a class of heavenly beings possessing extraordinary unspecified power. The word pair occurs in early Jewish literature in the book of 1 Enoch. 61:10, it says, perhaps they're the angels whom Yahweh has put in charge of the nations. There are demonic forces that are working right now over our government, over the media, over every part of our lives. They're trying to control us. They want to take over because the spirit of Antichrist is so active in this world. Principalities over Waycross, I would say, is a spirit of religion. You can't go to any store now that they don't say God bless you and have a blessed day, and all that sounds wonderful and great, but are they right with God? Are they right with the Lord? They may go to church, but are they right with God? Have they given themselves over to Jesus Christ to be Lord and Savior of their life? Are they born again of the Spirit of God? So there's a not only a spirit of religion, but there is a spirit of strife. Why in the world are there over 300 churches in Waycross? You can't even go two blocks without seeing another church building. But all of them are half empty or only a quarter of the building's filled. Why? Because they go to church and they get mad and they go down the road and start another church. And they get in that church and they get mad and they go down the church and start another down the road and start another church. That's a spirit of strife that's coupled with a spirit of religion. That's why there's so many churches here, principalities. The powers. That's the leading and more powerful among created beings superior to man. You cannot fight demonic spirits in your own power. You can't live an unholy life and expect to cast the devil out of somebody. Remember in the book of Acts, the seven sons of Sceva came along and they said, in the name of Jesus, come out. And the demons beat the tar out of them, made them run naked down the road. You better be right with God when you deal with powers. Rulers, that's the lords of the world, the prince of this age, the devil and his demons. Spiritual hosts of wickedness, that's evil beings that operate in depravity, iniquity, and wickedness. And we see it everywhere we go. We see it every place that you walk. You see those spiritual hosts of wickedness. I believe that some demons have more authority to work over cities because cities have allowed those things. Notice trends in certain areas, strongholds. Maybe there's civil unrest in a certain city because there's a spirit of murder and a spirit of hatred over that city. Some cities are more prone to homosexuality and cancer and disease and race hatred and argumentative and wars and hatred of the police and hatred of races and on we could name them. But you'll see them, they're over cities. And the Bible distinguishes demons, evil spirits, unclean spirits, spirits of fear, spirits of infirmity, legion, all kinds of names the Bible uses to differentiate between different types of devils. You say, well, what do they look like? They're spirit beings. So they can take on any form that they need to. They mainly take on the form of the person that they're inhabiting. Spirit beings, over 1,000 legion lived inside of the demonic of Gadarene. And Jesus cast them all out and they went into 2,000 pigs and they killed themselves. The pigs had enough sense. They didn't want those demons in them. But some report that they have seen demons. I've seen them on people. And the Holy Ghost has given me revelation. And I've seen in the spirit. They look like almost some have taken on forms of like a little hairy creature. And they attach themselves onto a person. We don't know exactly what they all look like. And I believe they can take on any form that they need to accomplish the works of Satan. Well, where do demons come from? There's different theories out there. One theory is it's the souls of bad men. When you die, that you become a devil, you know. I tease all the time and I say, well, Nancy Pelosi is so evil, they're casting her out of demons. But I don't believe in that theory because I believe that when a man dies, he goes to heaven or he goes to hell. In Luke 16, 22 through 23, the beggar died, the Bible says, and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in torments in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Revelation 20, 13 says, the sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. So I believe when you die, you go to heaven or hell. You don't come back as a demon or a devil or some ghost or something like that. That's just foolishness. It's not scriptural. The second theory that's out there that says, well, where do demons come from, is a pre-Adamic race of beings. Genesis 1:28 says, then God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And so people say, well, because he said to refill the earth, you know, replenish, whatever version you're reading of the Bible, that you cannot replenish what wasn't already plenished. I don't know that there was a race of people that lived prior to Adam on the earth. I don't know, and honestly, I don't care. I don't care. But I don't believe that's the demons. I believe, and I'm going to give you scripture here, Revelation 12, 7 through 9. War broke out in heaven, according to scripture. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon, the devil. And the dragon and his angels fought, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon, Satan, was cast out, that serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. That's Revelation 12, 7 through 9. And I believe that's where demons come from, the fallen angels that fell with Lucifer when he was kicked out of heaven. That's what I hold to. Whatever you believe, where they came from, you cannot deny the reality that they are here. You can't be around a deliverance service and see some devil speaking through somebody that you know it's not their voice. It's some demon's voice, to not believe in the reality of Satan. I've heard it all my ministry, so I know it's true. Well, what is their mission? What is their mission? Well, let's reestablish some facts about Satan, and that'll tell us what the mission is. Number one, we know that Satan tempts. He tempts us. And so demons tempt us too. We are fleshly beings and we love to sin. So sometimes demons don't have to work too hard because his old fleshly nature is bent in that direction. They tailor their temptation and torments to you many times based off your family history. Let me give you an example. My great-grandfather, Fred Hartley, had a horrible temper. All the family has told me stories about how difficult of a person he was and how much strife he brought in, and anger issues. And then his daughter, my grandmother, she also had those same tendencies. And then my dad picked up those tendencies. And guess who got it after that? This one right here in front of you. Well, I went to the altar one Sunday when I was about 15 or 17, somewhere in there. I went to the altar. I was sitting in church at Faith Memorial Baptist Church. I was sitting in the audience. The pastor was preaching. I don't even know what he was preaching on. He was a great man of God, and I loved him dearly. Whatever he was preaching was good. But that particular service, I'm sitting there, and the Spirit of the Lord gives me a vision, and I see my brother in a casket, and the Holy Spirit spoke to my mind and said, you put him there. And I said, I would never put him there. He said, yes, you've got to get control of your temper. I had such a horrible anger problem. And for several years, I had a horrible problem. But after I saw that great vision, I got up at the altar time, and I went and just prayed at the altar by myself. And I made a commitment to God that I would fight that and not pass it on to my children. And I'm telling you, there are times that I had to go pull weeds. I had to go and walk. I had to do things that my temper would get the best of me. And I would have to
just leave the room, and instead of fighting, instead of arguing, instead of carrying on, I'd have to go and do something different, because the Bible says, "Be angry and sin not." And so I had to get victory over this, and I'm very proud to say that my children and my grandchildren do not have this generational curse, this anger issue. And I had to put a stop to it. I had to take authority over the devil so that I did not pass it on to my children and grandchildren. And I've warned my children to do spiritual warfare, and I've taught them how to do spiritual warfare so that when this comes up, they're able to overcome it through the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Hallelujah. Demons will take your fleshly desires and use them against you. They will torment your mind and influence your mind. They'll whisper things into your ear. So you need to know the wiles of the devil, know their schemes. Ephesians 6:11 says, "Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles, the schemes of the devil." 2 Corinthians 2:11 says, "Lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices." If you know you're struggling in an area that the Word of God says is wrong, that it's sin, then you have to come before the Lord and say, "God, I need to fight the flesh. I need to put the flesh to death. I need to put the flesh in subjection to the Spirit of God." And you do that. But there comes a time where you've resisted the devil with your flesh. You've done everything to stop the flesh from doing whatever it is. And you're still tormented. And you're tormented. And you're tormented. And the Bible says that God will not allow us to be tempted above that which we are able, but will also with that make a way of escape. Start looking for the escape hatch. Look for the exit door. Start looking for that opportunity that God will give you to stop sinning, and he'll do it. He'll help you. He'll help you overcome the enemy if you'll just let him. If you'll just let him. Now, I'm going to stop right here because I think this other would take another 20 minutes to get through. So I'm going to stop, and I'm going to take it back up next Sunday as we continue in this series on is the devil real and how we handle that, okay? So I want you to start taking notice of your own actions. Are you constantly prone to loneliness? Are you constantly prone to unforgiveness? Do you have hard feelings towards people? Do you resent folks? Do you have a hard time forgiving people? Let me tell you, folks, if there is any area in your life, and you need to start asking the Lord, is there anything, reveal to me anything in my life that's not right with you so that I can change it in Jesus' name. See, I want to go to heaven. I want to go to heaven. I want to, you know, the Bible says no man shall see God. Without holiness, no man shall see God. I want to walk in holiness. That's why our church is called the Pentecostal Holiness Church, because we believe in holy living. We believe in living a holy life before God. And to get to heaven, we got to live a holy life. And so if we see there is something in us that's not right, we got to start praying. And if you need help, I'm here for you. I'm a phone call away. I'm a text away. I'm a messenger away from Facebook Messenger. We can do FaceTime. I can come to your house. We can talk. We can pray together until God gives you the victory, because you don't need to live under the influence and the oppression of the devil. Jesus said, "I came to destroy the works of the devil." And that's what he wants to do. And that's what he wants this church to do.
is destroy the works of the devil. We're going to see people come through those doors that are so messed up, but we're going to love on them. We're going to love them in Jesus' name. And when we get through loving them, or while we're loving them, we're going to teach them the Word of God. We're going to make sure they know their tools. And then we're going to cast the devil off of them or out of them, depending on the circumstances and how much they've allowed to get into them. And we're going to help them. They're going to fall. We're going to pick them back up. They're going to fall again. We're going to pick them back up. They're going to fall again. We're going to keep picking them up until they're able to walk on their own and be stable in God. I'm excited about what God is about to do through Bible Heritage Pentecostal Holiness Church. Let me ask you a question before I close this message. Are you right with God? Are you right with the Lord? If you're not, I want to pray with you right now for you to be right with God. Father, right now, if there's a person listening to the sound of my voice and they've never surrendered their heart and life to Jesus Christ, I pray right now in Jesus' name that they will be repentant in their heart. They'll be sorry for their sins. We believe that Jesus died and rose from the dead, and he's coming back for us. And so we believe in you, Jesus, and we invite you into our lives. We invite you into our hearts so that we can live a holy life. We need your help in Jesus' name. Now, Father, I pray for Christians that are struggling in areas, Lord. I pray, God, for wisdom and understanding to come into their heart and mind. And, Lord, I pray that you will give them an anointing. And I pray, Father, you'll fill them with the Holy Ghost. And, Lord, I just yield to you over and over and over for many fillings in the name of Jesus. And we thank you for it, Lord. Fill them right now with the Holy Ghost in Jesus' name. Amen. I can't wait till we can get back in church where we have in-person services and this virus is gone and we're able to slap oil on people's heads and hug them in Jesus' name. And I can't wait. Now, because of the uprise of the virus, we're erring on the side of caution. We're not going to have in-person services until February the 7th. But until then, just continue to watch us online and stay in the Word of God. And we love you. If you want to send in your tithes, mail them to 816 Columbus Street. Missions, don't forget missions in your offerings. We support 7 different ministries and 2 children. We take care of 2 children. And so we need your help with that, and we appreciate your faithfulness. God bless you, and we love you, and we'll see you Wednesday night. We'll be ministering. I think I got the exact title of the message right here. If my fingers will let me get this paper to turn. How can believers walk in darkness? How can believers walk in darkness? Join us Wednesday night, 6 o'clock. Can't be at 6 o'clock. Anytime after that, you can watch the service online. That's the good part about this. And watch it and learn, and let's get closer to Jesus. Love you. Have a blessed week. Praise God.